Good morning, Simple Church. Thanks for tuning in to 21 Days of Prayer this season. We're super excited to bring day 8 and to share it with you today. I'm Derek. If you don't know me, this is Pastor Aaron.
Hi.
Love to have you guys tuning in. This is the first 15, really, is what it is. We're encouraging you to take the first 15 minutes of your day and starting out in the Word and with Jesus ultimately. So you spend the first 5 minutes in the Word, which is why we're here. We're going to talk about from Mark today. You spend 5 minutes in prayer and then 5 minutes in worship. So once we're done with this video, we would love for you to take a couple minutes to pray, to ask Jesus what this means to him, to kind of noodle this out.
Yeah.
And then ultimately to find 5 minutes of worship and get alone and get quiet. I think it's going to make a big difference in your day. Actually, we know it's going to make a big difference
Absolutely.
In your day. And that's why we're here. So like I said, we're going to spend the first five in the Word. So today we're going through Mark 13. Mm-hmm. If you go in the journal that we gave you, the 21-day journal, it's actually on page 9. We'd love for you to check that out as well.
Yep. And if you didn't pick up a journal, you can get one today. I think today you should be in church today. So this is airing at 7 a.m. So if you're watching this early and you didn't get a journal, pick one up today at church. Right? Yeah. That should be right.
Sounds right.
Yeah. Okay. And anyway. Those are free, and you can follow along with us the next 2 weeks, and this will actually take you past
days.
It, because we're trying to put in a habit of 21 days, and that's why we're with you, and then we want you to do it on your own. So, okay, where are we today?
Mark 13. Yeah.
Okay, so...
What are you reading out of?
I've got the NLT, the New Living Translation.
Yeah, I've got the ESV.
ESV.
Standard, yeah.
Yep, okay.
Sure.
Do you want me to read out loud? I'll do it.
Yeah, go for it.
Yeah, okay, so here we go. This is the whole chapter, okay? So there are 37 verses. So I'm going to challenge you to get a pen or get a highlighter in hand. You're looking for one verse, that aha thing, that one thing that makes you go, huh?
Hmm.
Yeah, things that make you go, hmm, right? So that we want you to underline, because that is likely what the Holy Spirit wants to speak to you. Now, you may find that you've underlined several verses as you go through, but really we want you to whittle it down, land in one place, all right? Here we go. Oh, yeah.
I was going to say, the paper Bible is great for that, because when I'm on a podcast, I can like pause it and go take a note.
Yeah.
You can do it right here.
Yep. Totally do that. If you need a paper Bible, you can pick them up at the Connect Center. We've got them. They are free for you. So stop by and grab one.
Sure.
We'd love to give you one. All right. Mark chapter 13, verse 1 says, as Jesus was leaving the temple that day, one of his disciples said, "Teacher, look at these magnificent buildings. Look at the impressive stones in the walls." And Jesus replied, "Yes, look at these great buildings, but they will be completely demolished. Not one stone, will be left on top of another." Later, Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives across the valley from the temple, and Peter, James, and John and Andrew came to him privately and asked him, "Hey, tell us when all this will happen. What sign will show us that these things are about to be fulfilled?" And Jesus replied, "Don't let anyone mislead you, for many will come in my name claiming, 'I am the Messiah.' They will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and threats of wars, but don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. Nation will go to war against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in many parts of the world as well as famines, but this is the only the first of the birth pains, with more to come. When these things begin to happen, watch out. You will be handed over to the local councils and beaten in the synagogues. You will stand trial before governors and kings because you are my followers. But this will be your opportunity to tell them about me, for the good news must first be preached to all nations. But when you are arrested and stand trial, don't worry in advance about what to say. Just say what God tells you at that time. For it is not you who will be speaking, but the Holy Spirit. A brother will betray his brother to death. A father will betray his own child, and children will rebel against their parents and cause them to be killed. And everyone will hate you because you are my followers. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. The day is coming when you will see the sacrilegious object that causes desecration standing where he should not be. Reader, pay attention. Then those in Judea must flee to the hills. A person out on the deck of a roof must not go down into the house to pack. A person out in the field must not return even to get a coat. How terrible it will be for pregnant women and nursing mothers in those days. And pray that your flight will not be in winter, for there will be great anguish in those days than at any time since God created the world, and it will never be so great again. My goodness, this is not a very encouraging message.
No.
Jesus is laying it down about what the end of days will look like. Verse 20, in fact, unless the Lord shortens that time of calamity, not a single person will survive, but for the sake of his chosen ones, he has shortened those days. Then if anyone tells you, look, here is the Messiah, or there he is, don't believe it. For false messiahs and false prophets will rise up and perform signs and wonders so as to deceive, if possible, even God's chosen ones. Watch out. I have warned you about this ahead of time. Derek, go ahead and pick up 24 for me.
Sure. It says, but in those days after the tribulation, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give us its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. And then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. And then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things happen, or these things taking place, you know that he is near and at the very gates. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until these things will take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But concerning that day or that hour, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Be on guard. Keep awake, for you do not know when the time will come. It's like the man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his servants in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to stay awake. Therefore, stay awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or in the midnight, or when the rooster crows, or in the morning, lest he come suddenly and find you asleep. You don't want to be asleep when the master comes home. And what I say to you is, as I say to all, stay awake.
Man, Jesus was the original woke guy, right? He's like, stay woke, y'all. Not, of course, not meaning what we mean for it to mean today.
Pay attention.
Yeah, but pay attention. Like, be awake, watch out. So, man, this is a whole lot of, it seems like it's a lot of doom and gloom. And he's saying, of course, there is suffering and there is pain and there is persecution that is going to come in the last days when the world begins to reject Christianity.
Sure.
Kind of like they are now. Like, you watch what's happening in the news and what's happening.
Absolutely.
And what people are saying about conservatives and about Christians and blaming them for all of the world's problems. And in some ways, they're not wrong. We've misbehaved a lot and created quite a bit of issues, but that's neither here nor there. Jesus is talking about all the stuff that's got to go down.
Yeah.
That, you know, the from the desecration and the temple and the scars being blackened out, and oh my goodness, lots of just biblical prophecy that Jesus is laying out here. But in all of that, there's this great kindness. There's still grace. He's like, if it wasn't for the sake of my people, he said, those days, that they would have been longer, because this is God pouring out his wrath on the world. This is on those who have rejected him and those that have just said, finally and for all time, I'm done with God. I don't want nothing to do with him. And God's wrath is being poured out here. And he says, you know what? If it wasn't for my people, those days would have been longer. There would have been more, but they're shortened for their sake, which is just a powerful thing. So I don't know, Derek, what stood out to you as we read through?
I mean, for me, while it is a lot of doom and gloom, I think obviously the chapters before this speak to a lot of the great things that's to come after that point.
Yeah.
And I think this is just, not that it's a threat, but it's just a, hey, this is all the stuff that's coming, and just to be ready for it, you know. But it ultimately, it ends with that warning, like, hey, don't be caught asleep. I think, you know, I look back to when I was a kid, like, I love my parents. My parents were great. They weren't rough on me or anything, but there still was always that threat that when dad came home, you didn't want to be messing around, right?
Yeah, right.
No matter what, even if you were doing good things, you still were like, oh, dad's home. I'm doing better than I was a second ago, right? So just being prepared for that time. So it's like, I love hearing that, because it's that reminder to me that, you know, even though I'm trying to do good, I still have that thing that, hey, eventually God's coming back. Jesus is going to be here, and we don't want to be caught asleep. We don't want to be caught not doing what he's asked us to do, because ultimately, you know, we want to be good and faithful servants. So
The thing that stood out to me was just the birth pains thing. That he calls these birth pains.
Oh,
and
yeah.
When you think about birth pains, like, this is just the beginning of them he's describing. You know, birth pains are, all this is very painful. I'm not a woman and I've never had a child, so I cannot relate. But I hear it's pretty terrible. And I hear that it's a whole lot of questioning. Like, man, what is going on in my body? I've never felt this before. And then the actual pain of it and the recovery of it. But the thing about giving birth is that women have multiple children. And it's not that the pain's not terrible. It's that the joy on the other side of childbirth, the joy that is to be received, is greater than the pain that you go through.
It's
and
tough, but worth
we
it.
Know what the joy is on the other side of that, is that Jesus will come back. He'll rule and reign, and we'll reign with him. And that's the time that we go to heaven. That's the time that the rapture happens. That's the time that all of this this time here on earth comes to an end. And so while birth pains are not fun and none of this sounds fun, there is joy on the other side. There's much to be celebrated. Absolutely. Here. So today's one of those days, man, where I can read that and go, man, there's still so much hope in this. And so what about you? Man, there's a lot of verses there. What verse stuck out to you? Because, you know, there's something there for you. And there's also a response. Sometimes that response is worship. Sometimes that response is repentance, or I need to forgive somebody. I need to do something, or I need to be still. I need to wait. I need to be patient. What is that response? I have no idea what in verses like this the Lord is speaking to you, but I know He has something for you. As the Holy Spirit has told me so many times, there's gold in them thar hills. I mean, there's just good stuff in it. So what is God speaking to you today? Share it with somebody, not just on social media. Absolutely. We would love to hear it and read it in the comment section. What is the Lord speaking to you? What verse stuck out to you? Let's talk about it and watch it come alive. Amen, everybody. So today was day 8 of 21 days of prayer. This is your 5 minutes in the Word, which I know we spent a little more time than that, but you know, it's all right. So join us again tomorrow for day 9 as we continue to make sure we have this habit of putting God first every day in our life through 21 days of prayer.
Absolutely.
Thanks for being with us. Love you guys so much. Awesome.